since. It's been a long, a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
Good morning, Nancy.
It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die.
Good morning. Sorry, I was muted. Good morning, how are you?
Beyond the sky, it's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. I go to the movie and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother. And I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Lord, there have been times but I know change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there. Beyond the sky, it's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. I go to the movie and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother. And I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Oh, yes it will.
Good morning. Good morning. I am Josephine Fulcher Anderson, supervisor of the Ferguson Library South End Branch and the Bookmobile. And on behalf of Alice Knapp, president of the library, and the Ferguson Library team, we welcome you to our virtual space. We are in the information business, committed to creating exceptional possibilities and opportunities for staff and community to transform their lives. So we welcome you to the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Day celebration. And we are ecstatic to partner with the community in offering you this program. It is my pleasure to introduce our master of ceremony for the first half of the celebration, Reverend Michael Hyman. A man of many talents, a servant leader in the community as well as in his church. Mr. Hyman wears many neckties, hats, suits in the community. He serves as DOMA's Equity and Inclusion Director, former director of DOMA's Chester Addison Community Center. He serves on many boards, including the person-to-person board of directors and the Ferguson Library Board of Trustees. He was awarded the Community Person of the Year Award by the 100 Black Men. I could go on and on, but this program is about celebrating Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So stand for community. And others, I present to you our friend, our brother, Reverend Michael Hyman, our MC for the first half of this celebration. Mr. Hyman.
Well, thank you, Mrs. Anderson, for that warm introduction. I did not give it to you, so you've obviously been sleuthing around in different places finding information.
Librarian.
Yes, that is true. So we will all reference that. But it is indeed a pleasure that we are all here today and that we're joining together to celebrate the 92nd birthday of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Nationally, we've been celebrating this day since January 20th, 1986. However, in Atlanta, Dr. King's 40th birthday, which he was not here to be a part of, his birthday on that year, 1969, was actually celebrated in Atlanta. And it continued a tradition in that city. And also in Georgia, eventually the state of Georgia would honor their native son with a holiday in January, the third Monday in January. At the same time, it is ironic that they would also honor Confederate General Robert E. Lee, whose birthday was on January 19th. They would honor both of those men at the same time. The irony and the idea of doing that is beside the point these days, but that's what the state of Georgia did at that time. For me, on a breezy Monday, January 21st of 1985, I stood with my family and thousands of other neighbors from across Atlanta on International Boulevard and watched a moving tribute and with proud Atlantans, all of us of different races and creeds, beliefs, to celebrate an American whose words, his deeds, and actions demanded that America honor the words written in the Declaration of Independence and the US Constitution. So on this 18th day of January, 2021, or 2021, we're not here only to celebrate this man, but also to rededicate ourselves to the work, that needs to be done. No one man stands alone. This work is about all of us, and certainly our liberty, our freedom, at this very hour is endangered by things that are happening elsewhere. So a resolve collectively within our own communities is certainly very important for us to do. At this point, I would like to make sure that we take a moment. This is 2021, but in 2020, many of us wanted to get rid of that particular year, but it brought so much in so many different ways of challenge for all of us. And I would like for us each to reflect for a moment on the double crisis that has entangled our country. One of them invades the body, debilitates us, and can actually take our very lives. The other is racism that has been a part of the fabric of this country for more than 400 years. It has reared its head in an ugly way, and it will take all of us to think about and to decide and to commit ourselves to what needs to happen next. I'm going to ask us all to think of those who have passed over the past year, that we would take a moment of silence, and then we shall have a prayer. So for us here, we'd like to remember Jack Bryant, who led the NAACP, Elijah Cummings, the congressman from Baltimore, John Lewis, the congressman from Atlanta, who marched faithfully across the Edmund Pettus Bridge, and also here in Stanford, E. Philip McCain, who headed CTE for so many years, who those have passed along the way. I would ask for you to think of others in your own hearts, but let us for a moment make a or have a moment of remembrance in silence. Thank you. Dear Lord, we celebrate the birth and life of Dr. King. We thank you for the blessings that you have bestowed upon us for the 39 years that he was here as your servant, a man of peace who was able to inspire and provoke a sense of righteous indignation on behalf of the poor, the oppressed, and the forgotten. We pray that in his honor of national, or in this, our honoring him at this time of national emergency, that we remember your words that no weapon formed against us will prosper, for we are not afraid. We pray for the same strength and courage that you gave to our ancestors and elders, that we will meet this test while wearing the full armor of the Lord. We pray for our elected officials, those whose lives have been threatened, and for also for those who seem to have forgotten their calling for the nation and our Constitution. We pray that they will remember that you are all powerful, and that we, all of us, will stand collectively for what is right in America, to set the course on a path that is one of justice for all of us. Amen. And now, if I can invite Dr. Evelyn to bring to us a song. Is Dr. F here? The sharing of this song? Yes. Thank you, Dr. F.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on. Let me stand, I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When the darkness appears and the night draws near and the day is past and gone, at the river I stand, guide my feet, hold my hand, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home.
Thank you so much for that rendition of Precious Lord. It was one of Dr. King's favorite songs, as many of you may know. It was actually sung at his funeral, but it was a song that he called for on the evening of his death in Memphis. So now we will move along. We have a video that we'd like to share with you.
So even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will they be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day, even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day down in Alabama, with its vicious racists, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification. Yeah. One day right there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted. Every hill and mountain shall be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope. This is the faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This will be the day when all of God's children be able to sing with new meaning, "My country, 'tis of thee." Sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. And so let freedom ring. From the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire, let freedom ring. From the mighty mountains of New York, let freedom ring. From the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania, let freedom ring. From the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado, let freedom ring. From the curvaceous slopes of California. But not only that, let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain of Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and mole hill of Mississippi, from every mountainside. Let freedom ring, and when this happens, and when we allow freedom ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last."
We're all very, very familiar with that speech. And sometimes familiarity requires that we actually delve a little bit deeper. And so one of the things that we'll be putting in the chat about Dr. King is that if you're interested in doing some additional work and knowing a little bit more about this man, there are several books that we would suggest to you. One is called A Call to Conscience. It's speeches from Dr. King. The other is A Knock at Midnight. And then the third are actually three books, which I believe are the definitive biographies of Dr. King. They're written by the author Taylor Branch. They're long, but they give you everything. And so that we'll put those in the chat so that you might be able to get those books at some time. And now I believe we want to share with you that one of Dr. King's big ideas was that everyone had the ability to serve. If you'll play that video short now, I'd appreciate it.
True greatness comes not by favoritism, but by fitness. And so Jesus gave us a new norm of greatness. If you want to be important, wonderful. If you want to be recognize, wonderful. If you want to be great, wonderful. But recognize that he who is greatest among you shall be your servant. That's a new definition of greatness. By giving that definition of greatness, it means that everybody can be great because everybody can serve.
With no further ado, we're going to have another song by Dr. Evelyn Avagola, which then will lead us to some additional art. Denise Lyles from the Youth Services portion of the library will begin and share a story.
A friend by my side walking. There's a voice within me talking. There's a word that needs a saying. Carry it on, carry it on, carry it on. Carry it on. If you can't go on any longer, take the hand of your sister, your brother. Every victory's gonna bring another. Carry it on. Carry it. Says blending loud and clear, their echoes sounding. Carry it on, carry it on, carry it on, carry it on. Through the air, the song is winged. Down the years, hope keeps springing. No more tears, we're still singing. Carry it on, carry it on, carry it on, carry it on. Now we listen. To the ones who have departed, to fulfill what they have started. Carry it on, carry it on.
Hi friends, it's Ms. Denise from the Ferguson Library, the South End Branch. And today, in honor of Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday, I am going to read for you Martin's Big Words, The Life of Martin Luther King Jr. by Doreen Rappaport and illustrated by Brian Collier, courtesy of Jump at the Sun, a division of Hyperion Books for Children. Martin's Big Words. Everywhere in Martin's hometown, he saw the signs white only. His mother said these signs were in all southern cities and towns in the United States. Every time Martin read the words, he felt bad. until he remembered what his mother told him. You are as good as anyone. In church, Martin sang hymns. He read from the Bible. He listened to his father preach. These words made him feel good. When I grow up, I'm going to get big words too. Martin grew up. He became a minister like his father, and he used big words he had heard as a child from his parents and from the Bible. Everyone can be great. He studied the teachings of Mahatma Gandhi. He learned how the Indian nation won freedom without ever firing a gun. Martin said, love when others said hate. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. He said, together when others said separate. He said, peace when others said war. Sooner or later, all the people of the world will have to discover a way to live together. In 1955, on a cold December day in Montgomery, Alabama, Rosa Parks was coming home from work. A white man told her to get up from her seat on the bus so that he could sit. She said no and was arrested. Montgomery's black citizens learned of her arrest. It made them angry. They decided not to ride the buses until they could sit anywhere they wanted to. For 381 days, they walked to work and school and church. They walked in rain and cold and in blistering heat. Martin walked with them and talked with them and sang with them and prayed with them until the white city leaders had to agree that they could sit anywhere they wanted. When the history books are written, someone will say, there lived black people who had the courage to stand up for their rights. In the next 10 years, black Americans all over the South protested for equal rights. Martin walked with them and talked with them and sang with them and prayed with them. While ministers told them to stop, mayors and governors and police chiefs and judges ordered them to stop, but they kept marching. Wait. For years, I have heard the word wait. We have waited more than 340 years for our rights. They were jailed and beaten and murdered, but they kept on marching. Some black Americans wanted to fight back with their fists. Martin convinced them not to by reminding them of the power of love. Love is the key to the problems of the world. Many white Southerners hated and feared Martin's words. A few threatened to kill him and his family. His house was bombed. His brother's house was bombed, but he refused to stop. Remember, if I am stopped, this movement will not be stopped because God is with this movement. The marches continued. More and more Americans listened to Martin's words. He shared his dreams and filled them with hope. I have a dream that one day in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. After 10 years of protest, the lawmakers in Washington voted to end segregation. The white-only signs in the South came down. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. cared about all Americans. He cared about people all over the world. and the people all over the world admired him. In 1964, he won the Nobel Peace Prize. He won it because he taught others to fight with words, not fists. Martin went to wherever people needed help. In April 1968, he went to Memphis, Tennessee. He went to help garbage collectors who were on strike. He walked with them and talked with them and sang with them and prayed with them. On his second day there, he was shot. He died. His big words are alive for us today. Freedom, peace, love, together, I have a dream. Martin's Big Words by Doreen Rappaport and illustrated by Brian Collier. Bye, friends. I'll see you next time.
Okay. Well, lots of applause for that. I felt as though I was back in Romper Room to a certain extent of listening to something good, expecting that she would eventually say, I see Michael and I see all of you sitting out there. You know, we teach our children peace and love and freedom. We have to recognize, though, that it is also important that we know that these things don't come easily and that they are hard won and that they may not be lasting if we don't continue to fight for them. Certainly our words today are that we must be resilient and resolved and prepared to fight what is right, for what is right. At this point, we do have one of the favorite things that happened during the King holiday. Were we at Yearwood Center, this would be happening, and Nancy Coughlin, the president of and CEO of Person to Person, would be there along with Mrs. Anderson and others. And so that I'm going to turn it over to them so that this special presentation of the annual scholarship can be made. Nancy?
Hi, thank you, Michael. My name is Nancy Coughlin. I am the CEO of Person to Person. Thank you, Mrs. Anderson. Thank you, Mr. Hyman, and everybody who made today's celebration possible. Person to Person was formed in 1968 as a direct response to the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Today, we're a social service agency serving 28,000 individuals throughout Lower Fairfield County. Our mission is to provide equitable access to economic stability. This is a mission that was born directly out of Dr. King's Poor People's Campaign, which called for the end to discrimination in employment, meaningful and dignified jobs at decent wages, and a minimum wage act to give all Americans a decent standard of living. Interestingly, the $2 an hour that Dr. King was calling for in 1968 would be roughly equivalent to $15 an hour today. We provide equitable access to economic stability by providing financial support, material support, summer camperships to help working families, and also college and vocational scholarships. One of the scholarships that Person to Person provides every year is our Dr. King Scholarship. It goes to a college senior who espouses the and fulfills the goals of Dr. King's leadership. The money is paid directly to the student, and this year's scholarship is Imani Morgan. Ms. Morgan's currently a senior at the University of Connecticut with an individualized major of health, minorities, and inequality. She was originally a pre-med major, and her decision to create her own major exemplifies her commitment to bring attention to and create change for people and communities adversely affected by our current health care system. She was influenced by her service missions in Hearts Over Latin America, where she witnessed firsthand how where you live and who you are can determine your access to medical care. Amani's dedication to the important work has magnified during the pandemic. Not only is she professionally motivated to address the disparate impact of the coronavirus on the African-American community, but she was also profoundly personally affected when she lost her grandmother in April of 2020. We look forward to seeing everything that Amani accomplishes in her life. I have no doubt it will be great, and I look forward to seeing that. And it is my great honor on behalf of Person to Person to present Amani with the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Scholarship and also to introduce her to you now. Amani.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Hello everyone, my name is Amani Morgan. And this is definitely both an honor and a surprise. Service is never something that I expect to receive recognition for. It's more something that I do because I know it has to be done. Like Nancy was saying, I came into UConn as a pre-med biology major with the intent of going into medical school. I've wanted to be a surgeon since I was 10. And by around halfway through my undergraduate career, I realized that the pre-med students at UConn were not receiving the same social science education as they were the STEM education. So yes, they were learning about anatomy and physiology, but they were not learning about the social determinants of health and the things that were impacting marginalized communities. So I took a full 360 and decided I wasn't going to medical school anymore, and I wanted to turn my career towards social justice and seeking equity and equality in access to healthcare. So that is what I will be doing. I'm currently applying into the School of Social Work at UConn, and I hope to have a career in the nonprofit sector. I think the COVID-19 pandemic has definitely put my career aspirations into practice. Losing my grandmother in April definitely showed me that there is a disparate impact on communities of color as far as COVID-19 and other illnesses and things like that. So basically my goal for the coming years is to address that inequity in a lot of social factors, including education, access to affordable housing, employment. All of those things are connected, and they all relate to the intersectional oppression that all of these marginalized communities are facing. So again, I wanna say thank you. It was definitely an honor, and to receive the scholarship today in remembrance of Dr. King is definitely something that I will remember, and I really appreciate it.
Congratulations, Amani. You have inspired many of us, and just that talk of saying that you're honored by receiving the scholarship. We're honored that you're here and that you have professed to do the work or want to do the work that you've told us about. This is a wonderful thing, and we pray for your path and your journey along the way, but also that you know that the people, we're a community, and the people on this call are interested in how you do and what you do and how to support you with that effort. So go forward, but please stay in touch with all of us because we need you. And with that, we have another song that's coming up from Ayanna Dorsett. So we're going to listen to that, and then we'll be back for some closing remarks and a few other things of updating what's happening with the community.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna
That was certainly one of the most vocal and enthusiastic I'm Gonna Let It Shine songs or renditions I have heard in a long, long time. So we thank you for that blessing that has come this way for us. It is a wonderful thing. So what we want to do is to also make sure that you're aware that there are other things happening in our community that many of you may want to participate in. It's my understanding that the Avon Theater, through its Film Center, is offering, will be showing a documentary, MLK, FBI. It is based on newly declassified files of the government's surveillance and harassment of Dr. King to weaken his movement. I did mention to some of you that there is, or all of you actually, Taylor Branch does cover some of that particular material and the actual transcripts of some of those files in his books about Dr. King. So that it's widely known that the work that people did to stop Dr. King was unbelievable. There were occasions where one story I will tell you is that he had a meeting with the FBI and 48 hours prior to that, they had sent a tape to his home, which he did in fact hear and knew about, and nevertheless still continued on that journey to meet with J. Edgar Hoover and with others. I can imagine that they were startled to wonder, why is this guy here? We're throwing everything we've got at him and he's still coming in demanding freedom. So I would suggest to you that that movie is playing at the Avon and it's been there since the 15th, which is actually Dr. King's actual birthday. It will be playing through the 21st. You may want to go to their website and be a part of that. Another activity that we have is that on Tuesday, the 19th, tomorrow at 12 noon, and again, Tuesday, January 26th at 6:30, there is a race and religion forum that will be hosted by Stanford Stands Against Racism. And so that you may join in with that. There will be three faith leaders at each of those sessions who will be talking about their own walk and journey with race and what they've been doing in their own congregations. And then there will be a moderated forum with Lise Liss. Some of you may remember her from Future Five, but she has been doing some fantastic work on race and religion in her congregation. So that we'll put that in the that information in the chat as well. We look forward to you all being safe and that you understand that the work that we're about requires that all of us be a part of it. We do also have this afternoon, following this event at I believe about 12:30 or so, the Reverend Johnny Bush is on this call, as well as others, and there will be a forum on the COVID crisis, the double pandemic that we are facing in health and race, and Dr. Bush is with us. so that we do have some time that we may be able to actually talk a little bit about that. I see Ms. Anderson, would you like to say a few words?
Just want to say thank you, but I'd like for Reverend Bush to say a few words about this next session of our program. Mm-hmm. And Reverend Bush?
Oh my, I think he's frozen.
No, and he's muted. No.
Okay.
Is he frozen?
I believe he is.
Oh, okay.
No, he's not frozen. No, he's not? Okay.
He's not frozen, no.
My, he is very still then.
Okay. Yeah, he's frozen.
Okay.
I
truly want to thank everyone for your participation, for your prayers and cooperation. The Ferguson Library is your library. It's the heart of the community. And we invite you to visit the library. I will card everyone to make sure that everyone have a library card. So I'll have to do it virtually. If you don't have a library card, please make sure you get a library card for yourself as well as your children. We know that reading is power. We know that reading is knowledge. We have lots of books for children as well as adults. We have many programs at the Ferguson Library System. We have the main library, Harriet Bennett branch. We have the Weed branch. We have the South End branch. And we have the Bookmobile, the library on wheels. So we invite you to please use your library. We have wonderful librarians and staff here at the Ferguson Library. Again, we want to thank you all so much. I see Reverend Bush is moving now.
Yeah.
So praise the Lord. Reverend Bush, we were hoping that you would say a few words about the second half of our celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King's Day. Reverend Bush?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, we can.
Okay. Yeah, my computer was doing something, and you know, this is not my forte, but we're here. I'm glad to be here, and good to see everyone. And this is a note just to say again and express our gratitude to Ms. Anderson and the Ferguson Library from the South End. We are so grateful for the privilege of working together with what we'll be doing in just a little bit. I think we're slated to be on about 12:45 with a pastor's panel. And this is a local group of pastors from the African-American tradition here in Stanford who will be sharing with us. And they will be looking at, as a theme, a double pandemic and the intersection of health and race. And a couple of our panelists are with us right now. Pastor Charles and Pastor James are with us. And of course, we have a couple of other pastors, and we'll be moderated by another pair of pastors. So we are just delighted to be with you and have the opportunity to have a conversation about what is happening, and particularly in this time.
Well, we thank all of you for being here. The line is still open. We're not going to close out, but as others join, there is an opportunity to have just a free will conversation if you would so desire. So Pastor Bush, it's good to see that you are here, and Reverend Jean-Luc. Charles, it's good to see you as well as you, Reverend James. So thank you all for being here. And again, Imani Morgan, I am hoping that others in the community that you live in are on the line today. We want to broadcast this news to them. Imani and I go way back to the point where she was knee high. And it is really fantastic to see the young woman or lady that you've become. God bless you.
I would like to congratulate Imani for receiving a Martin Luther King Award. I have served on the a scholarship committee at Person to Person, I think for over 30 years, and I'm no way tired. And when I see students like Imani receiving the award and her goals and objectives for her life, I mean, it just do my heart so much good. Imani, as Mr. Hyman said, we are a village, and it does take a village. And I mean it, we all mean it from our hearts. If there's anything that you need, assistance, whatever, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. Nancy, I thank you all again in Person to Person for all you do. We really do appreciate it. And at this time, if there are reflections or anything that anyone would like to say at this time, we do have a few minutes. We are going to take a break, but this is the same link. You don't have to log off. Reverend Bush and the pastors, they are ready for this important, to discuss this important topic. So if there is anyone else on the line at this time, it's open. You can chat, reflections, say what you want to say in terms of Dr. Martin Luther King and what it means to you today to celebrate. Thank you. Do we have anything in the chat? Reverend Bush, I'm surprised we got all y'all preachers on here and you don't have nothing to say.
Well, I guess we're trying to save ourselves. Okay. Because we will, I'm sure there'll be plenty to say.
Yes.
But this has been a beautiful program, and especially I've enjoyed the artist who shared with us in music, and we're also delighted to share again, just in the legacy of Dr. King, who has inspired us all in so many ways. And I wanna shout out and say thanks to as many were able to go out with us this morning in the procession, the double procession. And what we tried to do was honor first through a memorial procession in one direction, honoring the lives of so many who have been lost to the COVID virus, and then the other length of the procession was to pay tribute to Madam Vice President Kamala Harris and to Black women in America in the leadership role and stepping up to the plate to help liberate us in so many ways. This has been a powerful season. And so we are just wanting to celebrate something. And so I want to thank those who were able to do that and share with us this morning as well.
Okay, Mr. Hyman.
Good here. Okay. So Reverend Bush, I know that that you all are ready to start. The pastors have, I gather they have joined us. And certainly the idea of talking about the COVID virus and what has happened within our community, I'm hoping that you all will address what are the things that we can and should be able to do about it. And that I'm sure that the question will come up about taking the vaccine. This is a huge issue for people of color about that sense of trust and the desire to do the right thing, but also being concerned that that possibly something can happen to those of us from taking that vaccine. So that we're looking prayerfully to you all to at least give us some insight on where should we go with this within our community. and to address it forthrightly and frankly with everyone about this. So I'm not looking for an answer now, but boy, this is the issue in the African-American and the communities of color about this particular situation here. We also understand that the virus is doing exactly what it's supposed to do. It's mutating. And so it's learning how to become stronger. As it does those things, what are we expected to do relative to staying inside, social distance, wearing a mask, all of those things? So how do we deal with that? And how do we encourage people to do what's necessary for all of us collectively? So I'm hoping to hear some of that during your conversation.
Yes, we will. There's plenty about all of that you've said, and your point duly noted. I warned the pastors about you as we were getting together. I'm about Brother Michael here, so we will speak some to that and a myriad of other issues that intersect these two directions of the pandemic, both race and health. And as you say, this is very, very serious and concerning for us, and particularly us, given our history. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. We have one last video.
Oh, forgive me. We do have one last video. We've saved it till the end, and we do want to, again, noting that everyone can serve. That's an important message. Doesn't matter your age or size. So we are going to play that video now.
If you want to be important, wonderful. If you want to be recognized, wonderful. If you want to be great, wonderful. But recognize that he who is greatest among you shall be your servant. That's a new definition of greatness. This morning, the thing that I like about it, by giving that definition of greatness, it means that everybody can be great. Because everybody can serve. You don't have to have a college degree to serve. You don't have to make your subject and your verb agree to serve. You don't have to know about Plato and Aristotle to serve. You don't have to know Einstein's theory of relativity to serve. You don't have to know the second theory of thermodynamics in physics to serve. You only need a heart full of grace. Soul generated by love. You can be that servant.
Thank you. We're going to take a little break.
Yeah.
And we'll be back with our pastors and the Dubba, the program of Dubba and Demity.
Double pandemic.
Dubba pandemic, yes.
It is, and that too.
Yes. Okay.
See you all in a few all minutes. Please don't all right. Off.
All right. Thank all you. Right.
Thank you. Thank you all. Nancy, thank you so much for sharing today.
Like the river I've been running. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother. And I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Lord, there have been times that I thought I could last for long. But I know change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother. Say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my
I'm able to carry on. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Oh, yes it will. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there. Beyond the sky, it's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. I go to the movie and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes it will. Then I go to my brother and I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Lord, there have been times that I thought I couldn't last for long. But I know change gonna come. Oh, yes it will. I go
somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother and I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my
Good afternoon. It's now time for Reverend Bush and the pastor to begin a second half of the celebration of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. Reverend Bush and panel.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you again, Ms. Sanderson. And I want to take this moment to say to all of those who are listening, we are thankful for the sponsorship of the Ferguson Library, the South End branch. We are so grateful for Ms. Anderson also, who has helped us going and coming with this. And we're just appreciative, and to have all of you with us today as well. I'd like to also welcome the members of our panel today. What we've attempted to do is bring our local pastors together, a number of them, and have a pastoral conversation. And of course, we've entitled this conversation today, A Double Pandemic, The Intersection of Health and Race. Again, I'll say, A Double Pandemic, The Intersection of Health and Race. And today we are grateful to be joined by the members of our panel. We have Pastor Rolita James from A Passion for the Truth Church. We're so happy to have her as a member of the panel. We are looking for, and hopefully will join us soon, Pastor Tommy Jackson of the Rehoboth Church. And then we are so delighted to have Pastor Jean-Luc Charles from the First Haitian Free Methodist Church. All of these are part of our Stanford and local community. And we look forward to hearing their perspectives today. And as I often try to distinguish sometime perspective from opinion, our opinions tend to be fleeting thoughts and ideas sometimes, whereas our perspectives are a little bit stronger in terms of how we really see things. What lenses are we looking through? And so our pastors are clearly not monolithic, but will come from their own perspectives. And so we welcome that today. we will be led by these moderators who are with us today, these great moderators, and they may take turns as to how they go at this, and they may take some license in how they may raise a question or somehow challenge or agitate our panelists, and in a good way, I mean. So I want to welcome Bishop James Hinton, pastor with Rose of Sharon Ministries. And we also welcome Pastor Joseph Ford of the Faith Tabernacle Missionary Baptist Church here in Stanford as well. So these two and will lead our panel today as our moderators. I am grateful to be helping to coordinate some of this. So if you see me moving in and out, it may be I'm trying to help to troubleshoot what I can. Again, we look and anticipate Pastor Tommy Jackson coming in. And if Pastor Jackson does not make it in, we will come with our plan B.
And Pastor Bush, I was just texting Pastor Jackson. He was on, but I believe he joined the other link. Okay. So he's now trying to get in with the correct, with this link now. Okay. So he should be joining us shortly.
Okay. All right.
Let me again thank our panelists, Reverend Rolita James and Reverend Charles for joining us for this talk. On the double pandemic, both racism and COVID-19. I believe that this will be a very fruitful conversation that we will be able to have on today. And so as we begin, the first question that we have for you, Reverend James, is Dr. King once stated, "Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter." What does that mean to you?
First of all, let me say thank you so much. It's an honor and a privilege to be here. I salute all of you pastors and men here. What that means to me is something else he said, that bad things happen when good people sit back and do nothing. Mm. That's what that means to me. Outside of marching, if you don't do what he did at the boycott and dig in somebody's pocket, no one's going to listen.
All right. All right. Pastor Charles, could you answer that as well?
No, that's such a great point. Again, thank you for having me and being included in this. I think that part of what I'm thinking personally is developing the kind of personal maturity to understand what matters and then organizing myself around that. As I've, probably over the last 25 or 30 years, I've been involved in some regard around the issue of race and racism in a variety of different groups, mainly evangelical groups. And part of what I found is in those contexts is one can get very tired of having the very same conversations over and over. So I've been around the mulberry bush so many times now that I'm really making choices in this part of my life around how do I want to spend my time? What do I want to do? And how do I dig deeper than what just stirs my emotions in a moment? So how do I reorganize myself as a person? How do I reorganize my finances? How do I align so that I can actually be part of this work over the long haul? So that silence isn't just the vocalization noise making, it's actually how is my life speaking and how do I want my life to speak?
Wow, that's a phenomenal answer. As we're talking about that, let me ask both of you, how or where do you think the Black Lives Matter movement intersects with King's legacy? You're on mute.
Oh, okay. Wow. I mean, those are great points, and I'd love to hear Reverend James also on that point. I think that the Black Lives Matters movement, first of all, as a movement that has taken up the mantle and brought to the forefront in a much more open and confrontational way, the issues of racism that have been part of the lives of Black people in the 80s, in the 90s, and the thousands. But they have, as young people, high schoolers and college students, just have articulated and really taken a perspective that they're not gonna just allow this to be a discussion in the background. They're actually going to make this matter in the Americas. So in that sense, that way of making the comfortable uncomfortable, they are enacting the legacy of Dr. King, who was very good at creating discomfort. He was very strategic at creating discomfort. And so they've taken that on with all of the barbs that comes with it, right? Of people attacking you and demonizing you. So so in that sense, you know, but there's so many other ways that I think that they're relevant.
Wow. Pastor James, do you have anything to add to that?
I concur. And I think the other thing that how the gap is coming closer together is it's lasting longer than 2 weeks. They're really understanding, as Reverend Charles said, when you make a decision that you're going to treat your money like your children, you're going to become more responsible. You're going to learn more about the economy. You're going to learn more. One of the things, if I may say, with the question is, we're starting to lack and miss the faith part of Dr. Martin Luther King. So while we are articulating what we see and what we don't like, he was a faith-based man, mm-hmm. where he understood with God, all things are possible. And that no matter if they put us in jail, no matter if they beat us, no matter what goes on, we're gonna stand on the word of God. So I believe that as we continue and as the young people, the millennials continue somewhere, somehow, also Dr. King, let me say this, they come together for one thing. They have to learn to come together with all the things and respect the leader that's in charge.
That's really good. I love the part around where is the relationship with Christ. You know, Dr. King was a Christian pastor, and specifically, it wasn't just a generic religious ideology. Ooh. You know, when you listen to his speeches, he's referencing the Old Testament, the New Testament. He is steeped in a belief that ultimately God will prevail and God will reign. So if the new movement doesn't have that kind of root, what will happen as it experiences all of the, you know, all of the pressures? And that's maybe something that we can offer in a very concrete way, which is to say, actually, faith in Christ matters, right? It matters to movements, and it matters to justice. And you may not see it today, but you'll see it tomorrow. So that's a great point.
And Reverend Charles, what you said, I'm sorry if I may, Reverend Charles, what you also said again, you implement it by your lifestyle. So when they can see it, and they can see it consistently, they will follow consistency. Because sometimes it's just waiting to see when it'll go away. There's a saying that says, let them throw a tantrum for 2 weeks, it'll be over. If we can tolerate the noise for 2 weeks, it'll go away. But if they see you implement your life and be consistent in it and be a man and woman of grace, a man and woman of integrity, a man and woman of God, not that you're not gonna make mistakes, but that you stay prevalent in their faces, something in here will say, I get it.
Let me ask you this, Pastor James. You said that they need to respect the leader, follow the leader. Let me ask you this, with this Black Lives Movement, what did you mean by that? Who is the leader?
I think I need to ask you that question. I was thinking the same thing, because I think that's where a portion of where we're missing it. Because if Reverend Joseph Ford becomes the leader, we want to dig into your family life, your personal life, what your issues are. But that has nothing to do with the capacity of you having the honor to lead, or you've been the one called to lead. And there's a saying that I say personally is the call versus the condition. Your condition is something else. But if you've been called, we have to learn to respect the call. For example, I remember when Al Sharpton had said, we're not going to buy gas. No one really respected him. And it was like, I got to go to work. I'm getting my gas. I don't care. And it was an epic fail. Whereas Dr. King said, I'm going to walk with you. I'm going to come down here and I'm going to go to jail with you. I'm going to get hosed with you. I'm going to get bitten with you. So whoever the leader is has to be willing to take that hit with them.
Yeah, and then I think along with that is that there's a new paradigm shift. There's a new paradigm in that that our millennials really have taken the lead on this. And I think as pastors, as faith leaders, you know, our thing isn't to be in the forefront. It isn't to be necessarily trying to take the mantle from them, but it's to offer them support. How can we help you? How can we offer what resources, what tools do we have that we can help you in this fight? We don't have to be the ones always in front saying that. We have to allow our millennials, and they've done a great job to now leading the movement.
Okay, I must say, I saw you, Reverend Charles. We were going back. Go ahead, Bishop Hinton.
I think that you guys, I want to jump in this. I have some comments also, but I think you guys are going the right way. And Dr. Ford, I think you just may have to stay on and answer some of our questions also. That's a good segue into a next question that we have. I'm going to propose this to Dr. Ford, if you don't mind. How would you describe and diagnose the pandemic intersection, that crossroad of health and then race? There's an intersection with this pandemic. How would you diagnose it and describe it?
Let me say, when we talk about there's an intersection between health and race, really, everything comes down to this pandemic. Comes down to race. Let's say that because when you talk about race, you're talking about part of the reason there's a health pandemic is because of the disproportionate amount of healthcare that minorities are able to receive. It is, and so because there's a disproportionate amount of healthcare, we tend to have more pre-existing conditions. We have diabetes, we have high cholesterol, we're obese. All of those things really contribute to the COVID-19. And so now we're at a higher risk rate of dying from COVID-19. We're in a higher category. And so it's really due to the systematic racism that we're already in, that we've already experienced, which makes us even more vulnerable, even more susceptible to what's going on. When you talk about racism at its core, you know, America has done things to make sure that minorities are not able to really get ahead. When you look at redlining, banks made sure there were certain areas that we were able to live in. And usually those were the lower income areas. Well, if you have a lower income area, that also means that the taxes for your schools aren't as much. And if the taxes for your school aren't as much, then that means already that the programs that our schools are able to offer and the education is already at a lesser rate than some of our well-to-do, well-funded other school systems. And so already we are in a, we are behind the eight ball. So it all goes together. It all comes together with that.
Sister Jeray says your point is excellent. I want to get with Pastor Charles real quick. The question was, how would you describe and diagnose that pandemic intersection of health and race?
You know, I wish that Imani was still on the panel because what she wants to study is exactly that area, which is the intersection of race and the social determinants.
Hello, can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Hey, Pastor Jackson, how you doing?
Man, I've been trying the last 25 minutes to get in and share with you guys and listen to the questions.
You are on and you're great. Thank you so much for able to get in. Right now, Pastor Charles is answering the question. One of them is, how would you describe and diagnose the pandemic intersection of health and race? So you stay tuned for right after Pastor Charles, okay?
And I heard Pastor Ford's response to that as well.
Good. Yeah, Pastor Charles, please continue.
I was just saying that there are social determinants of health, meaning that your health outcome is connected to your social space belonging. So for instance, if you, if the people around you, if your friends are have a high BMI, body mass index, are overweight, you are more likely to be overweight. But also, if you live in a neighborhood where there aren't pathways for you to walk, so either because it's not a safe neighborhood or because it's a predominantly car or bus neighborhood, that's gonna impact your health outcome. If you live in low quality housing, and if you live near highways and you live near a lot of busy intersections, then you're gonna expect that those areas, kids are gonna have higher rates of asthma. That means they're gonna be in the hospital more often. Their parents are gonna be out of work more often. So all of those things are overlapping and intersecting. And at the bottom of it all is white supremacy. So, you know, when people talk about, you know, people like to talk about race and race relations, there's no such thing as race or race relations. There's an ideology called white supremacy, which supports a particular economic positioning for certain people. And that positioning then assigns and says, okay, you're inferior, you're superior, work this way and you can reach and be like us. So for me, you know, dismantling that ideology in our own minds, in our own hearts, and wherever we are in our own sort of formation is an important part of also achieving good physical, mental, spiritual, and emotional health outcomes.
Great, thank you. Dr. Jackson, I know you are ready to jump on this here question. Take it away.
Well, good afternoon to all. My apologies for the technical mishaps that I had, but it's good to have millennials and Gen Zers who can put things together for you. So I'm grateful for my goddaughter in doing so. Thank all of you as well. Before speaking, I want to just remember and pay a tribute to three warriors who've died in the past year in the Stanford area community, Elaine Mitchell, John Furstner, and Phil McCain, who was funeralized this past weekend, who shared so much in our community to make it a better place. We have issues that are related to this pandemic that predate the pandemic. When we came here in 1619 against our will, we were brought here into this country and people came to talk about who we were and how we were and what we are. And in that 400 year time period, since that time period, we've been subjected to, impacted by, infected by the greatest disease and illness that the world has ever known, called racism, that was alluded to by Pastor Jean-Luc Charles. And in that context, we as the Black Church, E. Franklin Frazier in his book, The Black Bourgeoisie, written in, I think, 1957 when he was a professor at Howard University. E. Franklin Frazier said that the greatest, he said, the one thing that we've had in our community that we've always had has been the Black church. And I believe strongly that with this pandemic, and in order to get the information out, to get the information correct, we need the Black church. Our community trusts the Black church. We trust our Black leaders. If you look at all of our histories I talked about over the 400-year time period, the one place we were always able to go and to be somebody was in the Black church. And so we are grateful that we've had this institution over these years. And even when people have tried to berate us, tried to negate us, tried to put us down, it has not happened. Even when I look at today, that we're at the South End Ferguson Library, and let me salute Mrs. Anderson, Josephine Anderson, for having us there today. Her background is in the Black church, in the AME church. And so while I'm grateful for all the work that people in my generation, generations to follow, we need to stick together. One of the earlier questions was asked about people coming together to do things and making sacrifices. When I was a student at Morehouse College, there at Morehouse College, there was a woman, a professor by the name of Dr. Ann Grant. And Dr. Grant would tell us as students, she would say, all of us have a role in the civil rights movement. All of us have a role in our struggle for freedom. And that role is always the same for everybody. And she made a comment, she said, some of you are gonna get hit in the head and go to jail. Some of you will work as police to get out of jail. Some of you will work as doctors to bandage up the heads that have been busted. And some of you may work as bankers to get the money to support them. Some of you may be bail bonds persons to get them out of prison. Some of you may serve as judges sitting on the bench to make fair and equitable decisions. And so when we look at our lives as a people, we've long suffered from disparate impacts. We've long suffered from inequitable treatment. We've long suffered from unfair treatment. And when we talk about racism, one of the things that bothers me that I've heard most recently is people talk about systemic racism. But racism is also individual racism. There's institutional racism, and there's racism in the people who run these institutions. So it's not just systemic racism. It's nothing wrong with pointing to a leader who does not look like me and say, you are racist because of the behavior that you do. We have, as a concerned clergy coalition over the past several months, as some of you may know, we've been addressing issues with the administration in the city of Stanford and saying to administration in the city of Stanford, you cannot continue to go along the old path that you've gone along and think that it's okay that our people are going to go along with it. We're not going to go along with it. I feel like Fannie Lou Hamer. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired and tired of being sick and tired and tired and sick and tired. And so until we coalesce and galvanize our strength, because in unity there's strength, until we galvanize ourselves, we're not going to be able to address many of the issues that need to be addressed. And lastly, as I finally try to address the question that you raised, Bishop Hinton, on the intersection between race and health, a lot of this stuff is based on, and Pastor Charles alluded to it, zip codes, where you live, how you live, what way you live. You think about it in Stanford, two of the higher impacted areas with COVID infections, Waterside in Stanford and the Cove. And you look to see who are in those areas. The Waterside is one of the fastest growing areas in the city of Stanford, but the demographics show that it's being grown fast by a Latino population. The Cove has a mixture of Latino and Blacks there together. And so Black and brown people are being impacted by this. And one of the dynamics that interacts in this contact with race and healthcare is economics. I get to the doctor's office, if I have to catch a bus to go four places before I get to the hospital, if I need 10 appointments to schedule an appointment to see the doctor, all of those things can become discouraging, can become dismaying, can become depressing and distressing. And as a consequence of those deeds that I just gave, they become damnable. And our people continue to be damned by a lack of concern for us.
Dr. Jackson, you just answered one of the chat questions. The question was, can you discuss how race and economic impact how people were treated at the hospitals when seeking healthcare for COVID? I believe Sister Jeray Eaton posted that question. Thank you. I believe she touched on it. I want to take a different spin real quick. Many of us have not considered the twin-like nature of this pandemic. If health disparity and racism and bigotry were linked as siblings, brothers and sisters, from your perspective, which would be the elder and why? I'm going to propose that to Pastor James. You're muted.
You're on mute.
Thank you so much. I would say racism is the elder. And the reason why I would say racism is the elder is because I'm from a grandmother that passed away at 102, that was born World War I, 1914. So when it came to health, we had old school remedies. She gave us stuff from the earth. And again, being pastors, the Bible said we will be healed from the leaf of the tree and the earth. So they always gave us stuff from the earth. They always gave us stuff from our bodies that heal. But and because today's health, you get money from it. Whereas if they use the old remedies, you know, there's so many old natural remedies that came through the pharmaceutical industry that they said get rid of because it doesn't make us any money. I happened to live next door to a pharmacist of 43 years. And he said, if you only knew the natural things that have come through the pharmaceutical industry that they got rid of because it wouldn't make them any money, it would blow your mind.
My goodness.
So it's painful and it's powerful. And to just talk about why it's the racism is the elder, because they weren't gaining anything. That's always been my question. Why are you mad? Why? I had the privilege of speaking with Reverend Jackson and we were talking, why are you upset? You want to be the oldest, you want to be the, why? But with health, and another case, this is funny, but it's true. My grandmother was so upset one time, she went to Faith, bless her heart. And she said, we brushed our teeth with baking soda and peroxide in 19, and now somebody's getting millions. She was so upset because these were things that's all we had. So I would have to say racism is the eldest, when even Black women had children and they had to nurse white babies. We can't act like we don't know that this stuff is prevalent, it is real, and again, there's no one to give the answer why. It's just growing. And whenever, I think Pastor Jackson, can you answer this for me? I'm sorry. He said something that really stuck with me. You said we would never get the answer because, I think it was because of denial. What did you say? It was very profound.
What I said, I can tell you the truth, but then you have to go and seek the answer to the truth. And many people, after we express the truth, they don't want to accept or to deal with the truth. And we see a prime example of that Wednesday, January 6, 2021, in our nation's capital. The truth is that racism is alive and well. The truth is that racism still exists in law enforcement agencies. The truth is that law enforcement still exists in criminal justice entities. The truth is that criminal justice is that racism still exists in people who've been elected to office to do the right thing. Dr. King one time said, the right time to do the right thing is always the right time.
He
state that we can, and they were raising the devil with Dr. King about legislation for civil rights movement. He said, listen, I cannot legislate morality, but I can put a law in place that says, if you do that to me, it's wrong. And I think that we have so many, Pastor James and others who are, we don't have the sense of voice. We don't have a sense of conviction, if you will. And Dr. Marvin McMichael has written a marvelous book titled, Where Have All the Prophets Gone? We, the Black church, was always at the forefront of institutions and organizations. As many of you know, I grew up in Baltimore, Maryland. And in growing up in Baltimore, Maryland, we had Black hospitals that were started by the Black church. We had Black schools, Morgan State University, Coppin University, that were started by the Black church. And so the sense of knowing what the Black church did, how the Black church was involved, how the Black church was convicted and committed. We had the first Black mall in the United States of Maryland in Baltimore City, at a place on Darman Mall that was established by Black folk. And we had Black hospitals, Black medical facilities, Providence Hospital, the Godwin Medical Center. They were all done by Blacks who came up out of the Black church as the basis for what was done. And so, yeah, people talk about the Black church, I get offended. And when I go to the barbershop or any place, they want to talk about the Black church, and I first say, are you a member of the church? And they tell me no. I say, then you need to shut up, because you can't talk about what you're not a part of. And if you're not a part of the, you don't have to come to Rehoboth. You can go where you want to go and then go to that church and learn to talk about something. But you can't talk about my God and my people and you're not part of it. I don't accept that. That's totally unacceptable to me. And lastly, my last point is on this piece. I talked about Fannie Lou Hamer being sick and tired and being tired and sick. Two points. We talked about you, Pastor James, about stuff the earth. One of my great grandmothers had a box of soil that she kept under her bed. And I'm blessed that I knew all of my great grandparents. And when we would leave, we always had to go up to her bedroom, and she would take the box of soil from under the bed, put her hand in the box of soil and put it on our heads and say, never forget where you came from. Mm. And that's what you're saying.
It's getting, Dr. Ford, before you move on and take this, it's getting hot up in here. The commentary is good. And Dr. Ford, I know I want you to take this next segment, but we have someone else that's on the chat line, Brother Wilner Poppy Joseph. And I don't know if we can unmute him or not, but there's a question that he wants to propose to everyone, to the clergy. And I'll read it from him. Okay. It says, how do you see the clergy partnering with Black Lives Matter or young adults in general? How do you see us partnering and working together? I see some hands going up. People are ready to answer. The clergy's ready to answer this, but this is coming from Brother Wilner Poppy. And maybe the moderator can let him in, because there's a question we want to ask him also. Let's go with Pastor Luke Charles first.
Okay, I'm going to be really quick and then I'll let Reverend James answer. I would say that it comes with respect too. We tend historically to have a much more hierarchical perspective, like a hierarchical polity, right? We wear our robes. That's an important part of the Black church tradition, is our hierarchy. But we're dealing with a 21st century group of young people, and they believe in a scattered leadership model. They believe in a shared authority model. So when we come with a kind of earned authority, that doesn't speak to them. Yeah. It's something that I'm struggling with. It's something that I'm learning. But it's also something about the lack of knowing who you are and remembering where you're from part that I'm also trying to gather. So I'm going to pass it to my co-panelists.
Oh, I'm so glad you asked me, and thank you, Poppy. I honor you for you asking that question. I'm giving you the truth. My church, the youngest is 9 months old, and the oldest outside of Miss Betsy is 36 years old. So I deal with a very young church. So with you asking the question of the millennials, wait, he sent me the question. The clergy can only, I would suggest from my perspective, participate through the word of God. You can only participate through the word of God. When we talk about the millennials being leaders, at the end of the day, as Dr. Martin Luther King said, you can't lead until you learn to serve. So no matter how wild they are, no matter how their perspective is, sometimes there's a baby that think they know until they touch that stove. There has to be some wisdom there that need to learn to sit at the feet, just like there's a saying, leaders, readers. You have to learn to read. You have to learn to sit under the generals. And that's how you can have, the Bible says, I call the old because they know the way. I call the young because they're strong. We have to do it together. So when in with Poppy's question, I see the clergy partnering when the movement of the young adults understand they need us and we understand we need them. And let us operate in our functioning roles.
And let me say this though, I think sometimes we as pastors, we become too arrogant when we talk about we need to be the ones that are leading, that we need to be leading. Listen, what I see and what I understand is that we have to walk together, and we don't get respect just because of a title. We get respect because we earned respect, because we have walked right there with them. Right. I'm not just coming in into this. You know, while I was in Houston, you know, I would do a lot of things, and the young adults started respecting me, not because I stood out front, but because I was there at whatever they did, showing that, listen, I am in the fight, I'm in the struggle with you. And because right. I was there showing I was in the struggle with them, now they were willing to come and say, hey, pastor, how can we go to the next level? We can't just go in and demand respect, but we have to build that relationship with them if we're going to get that respect. And then they will come to you and ask for that leadership.
I think that what happens in the context is that we have to certainly do all that has been said. I was reading the Atlantic Magazine Journal back in December, and it had a great article about young blacks returning to the church. And that was followed up with another article by Christianity Today this month in January 2021 about young blacks coming back to the church. What I believe is that we have to make the church relevant. We have to connect with people. We have to understand where they are. Everybody is not born the same way, and everybody does not have the same privileges, if you will. And I use that word with some sense of hesitancy. But I think we have to be mindful of the fact that when we're in the struggle, we're in the struggle together. In Ghana, they have a word that's called Sankofa. And in Sankofa, what it means is that you reach back to where you've come from to pull others forward. There's a parable that comes from out of Ghana as well. Some missionaries were there, and they would place fruit on a tree. And when they would place the fruit on the tree, they would tell the kids who were part of their missionary group, whoever gets to the tree first gets to have all the fruit. These young brothers and sisters in Africa, in Ghana, locked arms together and walked to the tree, circled the tree together, and everybody touched the tree at the same time. Mm. They recognized common bond and in common relationship together. We are, at least I feel strongly about my call in ministry and pastoral ministry, is that part of my job is to be a problem solver. If I identify an issue for you, I should be able to give you an answer or answers for your consideration. And I think that too often what has happened in the church is that we've tried to dictate answers to people as opposed to listening to what their concerns are. And after we listen to their concerns, even from a therapeutic point of view, walking through them, working through them, and saying, let's find common ground. Mm. The last point is that we need to understand that we have a lot of resources in the church and a lot of resources in the pastors. But as pastors, we don't know everything. As pastors, we can't do everything. There's sometimes people come to me and they say, Pastor Jackson, we need such and such and so and so. And I say, I need to send you over here. This because that's not within my bailiwick. That's not my forte. I'm not a firefighter. So if your house is on fire, I'll tell you to call the fire department. All I know is spray water, but I might get up and put up the fire extinguisher and burn your house down. So I try to stay in my lane.
Amen, amen. Dr. Ford, I know you're taking it over, but—
No, ask that other question from Poppy.
I would also, is Poppy, are you able to talk? Did they unmute your mic?
I guess not.
Okay. I don't know that they'll be able to do that.
Okay, great.
Right now, at least. The second question was,
do you believe the youth, we're going to switch a little bit. Do you believe the youth take pandemic and COVID seriously? If not, why? And what would you say to them to make them believe this pandemic and this COVID is real? Let's go to Reverend Charles, go ahead. Do you believe the youth take this pandemic and COVID seriously? And if not, what would you say to them to make them believe it's real?
So, I think in our congregation, we really struggle with that. We've had different, so at the beginning of the pandemic, you know, we hesitated about reopening, and a lot of our young people were like, we need to reopen, we need to reopen. But when we talk through their own understanding of the science and what was happening, I realized there was a gap. And part of my job was to help educate them about, how do you think about this? Okay, you want to reopen, that's great. Here's some articles that I've been reading. Now you read those articles and you bring something back to me. And as we talk through that, that changed some people's minds. Other people, you know, they're in their 20s and they believe they're immortal and nothing's going to change that. So, you know, I was in my 20s and I sped cars and, you know, drove 90 miles an hour and, you know, cut corners and like live like, you know, I was Superman. So there's a part of you just hold your breath and you try to get through. The third is that they may not always have the psychological reserves to deal with the reality. So this reality is requiring resilience, it's requiring creativity, it's requiring sacrifice, and they're just getting into that unless they've had some life experiences that have caused them to develop those skills. So I believe they don't. They don't understand the science. They don't understand what's required. They're confused by the different messages. They're confused by a community that globally says, you know, you have senior people in government saying you don't need to wear a mask. They're listening to all of that stuff and it's having an impact.
Wow. Does any other panelists want to take that question on?
If Pastor James doesn't want to, I'll just.
Thank you. I'm between texting Poppy and talking at the same time. Do you believe that the youth take the pandemic seriously? I believe, in my perspective, in seeing, and I'm going outside of my church because my church takes it seriously. However, I also believe, like America, if it don't hit your house, you don't take it seriously. And a lot of people don't take things as serious until it hits their home. And then they want everyone involved, then it's serious. And I can admit, even when it came to cancer, me being a cancer survivor, cancer wasn't that big of a deal because no one in my family ever had it. And I don't know, that was their business. Until the doctor said, it's going to your brain and you may never talk again. And even then, I didn't take it seriously. My assistant studied and said, no, you don't understand. You could die. And when they went and got the biopsy, and I'm going somewhere with this story, when they went and took the biopsy, Yale University said, no, you don't get to go home. You stay. We're going to cut you today. That's when it became real to me. It wasn't real until they said, we're going to cut your throat. And in reality and truth, when they said that, the lady said it, I guess, so I would understand that they gonna cut my throat. I said, cut, C-U-T. And they have a video where I ran out the hospital, but security and everybody was there. Why? Because people who don't understand something, they run from it. They avoid it. They act like it's not real until it hits their house. So with the youth dealing with COVID, they going to the club, not wearing masks. They going out thinking it's not bothering them. I know they hate it. And a lot of people, we don't like being uncomfortable. So we want to breathe. So we're like, if they came to the club, they must not have it. If they're at work, they must not have it. If they're this, and even now with COVID, people are asking for insurance. And if they don't have it, they're gonna avoid it. And they're gonna say, if I still feel good, I must be good. So to his part B is, how do we make them believe it? I believe with Reverend Charles is, we have to give them truth, because there are some things with the young people, this don't make any sense. How do you get a vaccination shot and then there's a new strand that won't protect the new strand, but it's the old? Then they say, you know what? Forget it. I don't want any of it, because it seems like everybody's lying and no one knows what's going on. So we need to find the truth and give them the truth to help them believe it.
Pastor James, as you say that, you know, we're focusing on youth, but the truth of the matter is, it's our, many of our older congregation members too. You know, when we look at Thanksgiving and Christmas, you know, the health department told us right off the back that we should limit gatherings, you know, and I was talking to people. They said, oh yeah, we're having 15, 20. I said, huh? Weren't we just told that we're in a pandemic and to limit to no more than 10 people at the most, no more than our immediate families? And so across the board, really, we are having a difficult time really adhering and realizing that, you know, COVID is real. And like you said, until it hits your house or somewhere close to you, then it becomes more real. And then as you talk about this vaccine, Pastor James, you know, there is much hesitation and rightfully so. We don't know what the long-term effects will be. We've seen in the past how minorities have been used as guinea pigs to make sure that in medical trials and everything. And so that's still in people's mind, in the forefront. We don't know what's going to happen 10 to 15 years. There's no study for that. And so there is a lot of hesitation. I was talking to a couple of people. I said, are y'all going to get the vaccine? They said, well, no, because I don't know how it's going to affect me. And I can respect their reasoning and the way they come up with whether or not they're going to do it. I'm not a healthcare professional, but what I see is, for me, I am one who believes in the vaccine, number one, because I want to keep my family safe. I understand that I'm out in the streets a lot. As a pastor, you know, I have to go visit the sick. I'm doing funerals of those who have passed from COVID, in addition to other things. And so I understand, last thing I would want is to bring that into my home, to bring it into my congregation. And so whatever I can do to stop the spread of it, I'm willing to try. No, I don't know. But we don't know a lot of stuff, but we walk on faith. I'm going to walk on faith and I'm going to pray. And that's this faith. Vaccine, like everything else.
I want to add this.
Dr. Jackson, hold on. I'm sorry. Dr. Jackson, go ahead. And I have a question for you as well. So go ahead first, sir.
Okay. I think that I want to answer the question several ways. One, I will take the vaccine. I've said to my congregation, whether it's Moderna, whether it's Pfizer, whether it's AstraZeneca or Johnson & Johnson, I'll take one shoulder, one the other shoulder, one in one thigh, and none in the other thigh. All four of them I'll take because I want to try to keep on living. And I think that we have to help people understand that faith and science are not in contradiction with one another. Reasoning, as we look at it, I believe that God has sent doctors, nurses, I'm gonna use Pastor James as an example, for our healing. I have some underlying conditions. And so I make sure that I handle those things appropriately. You know, sometimes we think we are invincible, as someone else said, so I think as Pastor Charles said it. You know, one day Muhammad Ali, I'll just say this as part of the narrative and I'll turn it back to you, Bishop Hinton, for the question. Muhammad Ali was flying on an airplane. The flight attendant came down the aisle and said, you need to put your seatbelt on the airplane. And Muhammad Ali said, Superman doesn't need no seatbelt. And she said, yeah, Superman doesn't need to be on the airplane either.
he showed down. Dr. Ford, real quick. We have about, I think, 10 to 12 minutes left before this is supposed to end. But Dr. Ford, America has been in the epicenter of this COVID-19, having as many as triple number cases and deaths. Why do you think we in America, or do you think we in America, have done a great job of allowing so many people to die and so many people to be infected?
I like that sarcasm, let me say that. I think it's due in part to a lack of leadership. Whenever there is a lack of leadership, you will see the suffering, and that's what I see right now. So yes, America has done a great job. And the truth of the matter is, even during pandemic, somebody's getting rich. The rich are getting richer. The poor are getting poor. All you have to do is look at, you know, the payment protection program and those who are getting these loans and everything. Listen, they've given the regular American this last time $600. Before that, what was it before that? Now, I'm going to tell you, that doesn't go very much. $600 in Stanford isn't even going to pay your rent. But these corporations are getting billions of dollars, and it's supposed to be a trickle-down effect, but the money's not coming down. It's not being used to help those individuals that actually need the help. And so I believe that in some way that COVID, you know, we allow it to go on because they know corporations know they're going to get richer, which has happened. And we are the ones that suffer the brunt of what's going on. I want someone else to answer that as well.
Pastor James?
Yes. The pharmaceutical industry gets $36,000 per case. I was out in the Philippines and in Thailand, India, and Dubai. And the way they handle it is strategic and cautious. So I kind of, being in America and watching the way they do it, the job, I'm not sure how great it is. Because again, in the airport, let's just use the Philippines, for example. In the airport, almost every 30 to 40 steps, you're getting your forehead checked. You're getting things done. You cannot go to the bathroom without going back through security. There's certain things with COVID that they are double checking and making sure in your rooms and things like that. When we flew, when we went to Thailand, the same thing on the plane, they're zapping, they're checking, they're doing things. And thus the COVID rate is different around the world. In Africa, it's, we just have to continue to get the information of the facts. Because did they do a great job with all of us dying, with people dying, with funerals, with in New York, with people getting put in boxes and you not even be able to identify your family, with dealing with people dying and being on Zoom, having funerals? How do you deal with coping and getting counseling for watching your mother and father die and you can't touch them, you can't be there, you can't be around, and they're just saying, this is the way you pointing. I'm gonna stop.
I know that Dr. Bush, we have about 5 minutes left.
We got more, we go until 2 o'clock.
Yeah, we go to 2 o'clock, we go to 2 o'clock.
Dr. Jackson, let's hear from you on that same question then.
It's no joke that pharmaceutical business in America is big business. It's major business. It ranks right up there, right near or right behind the oil companies. And people need drugs. They need drugs in many ways. And I think that if you need medicine for your health and for your well-being, we have to be cognizant of the fact that we have to raise these concerns over and over again. One of the things that has startled me and has alarmed me and troubled me over the past 12 years, I say 11 to 12 years, has been the Republican thrust and concern to beat back the Affordable Care Act, also known as Obamacare, that this program has been one that has assisted many people who did not have insurance, would not have had insurance, and not have made it. And we have to continue to hold on to what we're holding on to do what God has called us to do. And I think that if we lose sight and lose focus of the fact that whether we're going to these drug companies and saying, give the medicine to the community at a reduced cost, give it medicine to the community at no cost, however it needs to be done, pharmaceuticals are making boatloads of money without any return to the communities, and especially without any return to Black and Brown communities. And I know that I've highlighted in many of my comments here today issues related to Black and Brown people, but I'm Black. And that my first concern is who I am and the community that I serve. And I hope that that is as Jude speaks about and First John speaks about for our healthcare and for our well-being, it's there. And I want to just digress for 1 minute to the question that was raised earlier by Poppy, by Wilna Joseph, and that is that we need to be concerned, in my opinion, about elders and young people. Pastor James gave the text. The Bible calls the old for their strength, and calls the young for their strength, and the old for their wisdom. Let's be strong and wise together, and issues that impact our community. COVID doesn't seem to be going away anytime soon. And the young people and old people too, anybody who thinks that they're gonna get away without this vaccination. I had a pastor tell me, he was really jumping on another pastor who happened to be a friend of mine, saying that the pastor told his congregation to take the vaccination. I've called members of our congregation because we've not been in worship physically since March. We've been doing virtual worship. And I thank God that the congregation has been faithful, but I'm not encouraging our congregation to come back into the building that we worship, the church, our temple, until such time that we know that it's there. And one of the things I'll just say that I've used as a guide is that I said, we'll know when to go back to church, when Wall Street is called back in session, and when the folk in the United States Senate and the United States House of Representatives, they're not just hiding to try to escape the Proud Boys and others from killing them. We'll know when they go back in session. We need to go back in the session. But
all right. We'll
know to go back in session when God tells us to go there.
Yes. Let me say this, because we are running out of time, but there was one question that just came up that I'd like to hear your thoughts on. What are your thoughts on Trump's Patriots praying as they took over the House on January 6th? And even sat in the VPC.
I'll just say this one word, they're full of shenanigans because I can't cuss today.
So let me say this. Let me say that part of our prophetic work has to be the salvation of our white brothers and sisters. And I know we don't want to hear that, but we Christians. Now, after we cuss them out, we still have to help them to see Jesus, because that part of the split in the body of Christ, that's our work. Black people who don't believe in God, they can't do that work. I'm very interested in what's unique about being a Christian versus any other part of my identity as a Black person. And so the redemption of the symbols, the redemption of what it means to be a Christian, the redemption of the message of Jesus, that has to be our continued push, both against those who have the sort of soft shoe racism, as well as the ones who have the hardcore. And by soft shoe, we were talking about the statement that the six presidents of the Southern Baptist Convention seminaries put out, where they were criticizing critical race theory. And somebody has said, how ironic for an organization that was founded by racist and slaveholders and for this organization to be upholding all those people, but they got an issue with Black people talking about and pointing out racism. How ironic, how convenient. But it is still our work to figure out how to bring salvation, how to bring that light, and how to do it from within the language of Christ. Is it gonna be easy? No. Are we going to lose it? Yes. But it's still the cross that we carry as Christians, yes. As Christians, not as Black people, but as Christians, as Black Christians.
I just want to say this, Pastor Charles and others. The Bible teaches to me that the kingdom of God suffers violence, and the violence taketh by force. If I read the Bible as a whole, Old Testament and New Testament, I know that God is a God of grace. He's a God of mercy. He's a God of justice. And so I have to be mindful of that. But I I'm from the Maryland, D.C. area, the DMV, and I made a joke with some people last week. Had Marion Barry still been alive and the mayor of Washington, D.C., that incident that we saw with them storming the nation's capital and all that other stuff, and with Trump going down there in June with the Black Lives Matter and stepping out in front of St. James Episcopal Church, holding the Bible upside down, that would not have happened with Marion Barry as a mayor in Chocolate City, Washington, D.C. It would not have happened. Marion Barry would have gone over to Union Baptist Church with Pastor Wilson, got the brothers and the sisters. That ain't happening. No, 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 no.
It's getting hot up in here again.
to end.
And I think, you know, America has bought into this evangelicals, let me say that, has bought into this idea of Christian nationalism, which kind of fuses, you know, God's will and the American will, and that God is always behind America. And we've used it. We've done horrendous things in the name of God and missionary. We've sent people on missionary trips, you know, in the name of God, believing, you know, that God was, it was God's plan and design for us to that America, not us, white evangelicals, that they would overtake and bring some form of religion that they thought we didn't know anything about. Because I say thought because we knew about God way before they even came to our land. And so we have to, number one, counter that idea of Christian nationalism, that no, God is not for America. America should be on God's side. God ain't on America's side. And when we understand what God would want, you know, when we separate the two, one of the things I have a problem with, you know, and I know is, I know I'm probably going to get roasted here, and that's all right. But growing up in church, you would always see the Christian flag and the American flag. Those are two different things. And when you have that American flag there, you set it up to be used as a demigod, as what we have seen. That's what happened on January 6th, that these individuals have used their demigod, America, because God has to be behind America to take what they believe is rightfully theirs, because it can't be that if they voted, how can some black folks or some minorities tell them something different?
Do you know what, Reverend Jeremiah Wright said? What Reverend Jeremiah Wright said? What Reverend Jeremiah Wright said in 2002 about America? Reverend Jeremiah, who was formerly the pastor of Trinity United UCC Church in Chicago, Illinois, President Barack Obama's former church. Go back and recall what Jeremiah A. Wright Jr. said about America. The Reverend Dr. Raphael Warnock paraphrased him prior to running for the United States Senate and winning, hallelujah, last week, about what happens with a nation who has all of this sense of self-entitlement, or as you put it, Pastor Ford, demigods, and thinking that this things are right. Who gives a darn about Franklin Graham talking about he supports Donald Trump? Who gives a darn about Joel Osteen and humanism talking about supporting? Yeah, I'll call the names, because they can't do nothing.
All right, wait a minute. We got 10 minutes and 9 minutes.
Where do we go from here? Because this is a great conversation.
Where do we go from here? First, before we go from here, we're going to get this group together again. This will not be the first or last time that this panel comes back to us. Someone from the Bible study UBC Stanford says, as a community, we must be proactive. This is an opportune moment for us to become better about our mind, body, soul, and spirit, which leads me to our two last points, and we'll randomly pick. What can you share with us words of wisdom, and how do you keep the faith and hold on to the good news that we're supposed to continually share and shed? Pastor Charles, then Pastor James, and then another action step, and we're going to close out. Pastor Charles first.
I would say the words of Jesus in Matthew, you know, all power has been given to me in heaven on earth, that's where we stand. We stand with the risen Savior who has all power in his hand. And there's not a square inch of this earth that Jesus has ceded to the power of evil. So if we walk with him, if we walk in the light, then we'll have what it takes to continue to battle the forces of darkness. And what St. Paul said in Ephesians, that that we wrestle not, that we put on the whole armor of God. And that's how we do our fight, through the whole armor of God. So we got to be rooted in Christ for all of this.
Pastor James, again, how do you keep the faith and hold on to the good news? Share some wisdom with us.
I believe that we should stop fighting one another as preachers. And when they see us stop fighting one another and saying which church is wrong and which church is right, the Bible says, this is how they will know that you are my disciples, is by the love that you have one for another. And to answer your question along with you raised, the truth of the matter is there are a lot of people in church that are fans that need to be followers.
Action steps, path forwards. Dr. Jackson, Dr. Ford, I want you to give us some things we could do to move forward. What should we as a community do? What should we as a clergy do? What should our young folks do? Give us some action steps on how we can move this thing forward and summarize it up.
I think it's first important that we coalesce together, that we say, as Pastor James just noted, that one Lord, one faith, one baptism. I don't have a fight against any of my brothers or sisters in church. That's not my issue. As she quoted John 13:33, by this should all people know that you're my disciples, that you have love one for another. Those things are critically important. But I think until we are able to galvanize and coalesce all of our respective, come together out of our silos and say, we are a community. We are a community. We need the links as much as we need the guardsmen's. We need the boule as much as we need the kappas and the Qs and the alphas and the sigmas. We need them as much as we need the deltas, the AKAs, sigma gamma rho, and zeta phi beta. We need those together, and we need the churches together. It doesn't matter whether you're AME, Baptist, Pentecostal, Church of God in Christ, whatever. We have a commonality. And if we look at that commonality, it's critically important to work together that way. The late Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois, when he finished his PhD at Harvard University, around the time that the pandemic was happening in the 1900s, 1917, 1918, when he wrote The Souls of Black Folk, he was rejected by our community. He had been a founding member of the NAACP. They were rushing to push him out. He was teaching at Atlanta University. They kicked him out. He had to go to Wilberforce University, a church school in Wilberforce, Ohio, with the AME Church. And I think that it's important to recognize that with all of our diverse opinions, diverse perspectives, diverse views, that we are still one. We're still one in the Lord, we're still one as a people. And no matter where we come from, we are people in diaspora, our roots going back to the motherland, we've got to be able to say, let's come together. So, and if we do that, this is going to may sound funny. Richard Nixon in 1968, when he was running for president, had a saying called PUT, pulling us together. Can you believe that, Richard Nixon, pulling us together? And so I think we have to pull ourselves together and recognize that looking for the man, if you will, and the system to do stuff for us, that's not going to happen. We have the resources within ourselves and in our community to say, as one, we can do this. And as one, we will be stronger. So let's lay aside all the petty differences to say, let's move forward. That's the first
thing. Dr. Ford?
And I concur with Pastor Jackson that we must be about business. It's not enough just to preach, but we have to come together and become involved. That may look for some like running for office, because we can't change if we're not in those places to make change. And so we have to run for office. There has to be those who don't mind going, speaking truth to power, to stand up to our leaders and legislators when things are not right. We have to challenge the status quo. And I am thankful for our Stanford Pastors Coalition, because that's what we have started to do. And we have to continue that fight. And I believe that's what God has called us to do. And then we have to empower and educate ourselves as well. Because listen, if you're ignorant, there's not much you can do. But when we know, and they know that we know what's going on, it's a lot harder to turn us off when you have the education on your side as well.
Amen, amen, amen. Dr. Bush, take it away. I want to thank you for allowing me to moderate. And if I can say one thing, get involved. Don't just sit home, whether you're clergy, whether you're Black Lives Matter, whether you're red, yellow, purple, green, I don't care. Get involved. The only way change takes place and change becomes a movement is if you get involved.
Before Pastor Bush takes over, Bishop Hinton, I just want to say this one thing. When God blessed me to come to Stanford 23 years ago, I met a woman by the name of Annie Somerville McAllister. And she's now, she's been on the Board of Representatives since I got here. One of the first things she said to me in the conversation I had with her, because the church I was serving at that time was in a district, she said, remember this, Reverend Jackson, I know you've been involved in politics where you've come from, but you got to stay in it in order to win it. Mm-hmm. That goes to what you, Pastor Bishop Hinton and Pastor Ford said, you got to be in it to win it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would say to all of our participants who are sharing with us, if you want, you could give our panel and moderators a hand, a virtual hand, so to speak. And an array of experience and wisdom and knowledge and exploration, because at some points, the panelists were just as aware as the rest of us. We don't necessarily have all the answers, but that we're in it together. And so I'm delighted for where we've been today. And I want to thank again, Bishop Hinton and Dr. Ford. Thank you for leading us as moderators. And again, our hats are off to Reverend Charles, Pastor James, and to Pastor Jackson. Thank you for your words of wisdom and in what you've shared with us today. And for those who were able to get a question in or a comment, those who offered whatever you offered through the chat, we thank you as well. It has been a blessing to share with all of you. And again, a big hats off to you, Miss Josephine Anderson, for your support and your work. Brother Michael Hyman as well. We're thankful for all of you helping us out as pastors. And we do look forward to doing more. It takes a lot of work to bring pastors together, number one. And pray for us. as we try to serve you.
Amen.
Amen.
Reverend Bush, may I say something?
Yes, ma'am.
Just thank God, first of all, and thank you all for such a rich, fruitful conversation. I don't believe in one-shot deals, okay? A double pandemic, the intersection of health and race, and I feel that the conversation should continue. So if everyone is in agreement, you know, it's just like repetition is good. Publicity is good. We have to keep praying. We have to keep pushing. We have to keep sharing. So this one time is good. We'll leave, oh, that sure was good. And then we're going about our business. So I would like to see the conversation continue. Yes, can ma'am. I get an amen from some of y'all preachers?
Yeah.
Amen.
I tell you, and Reverend James, I praise the Lord. They had a woman. I just said, hallelujah. That was just my little bit, but I really would like to see the conversation continue. And Reverend Bush, if you and I, Mr. Hyman, can work on that with the rest of the pastors and the community so we can have, you know, the congregation and other people from the community to be involved. Like, we can do a series of things. So
I would look forward to that.
Pastor Bush?
Yes.
I wanted to say what Evangelist Anderson, excuse me, you know, the missionary Evangelist Anderson, this morning, Pastor Ford and I were talking about, we have our Black History Month coming up next month. And I spoke to him about maybe we could do something on a weekly basis on Wednesday nights when we're not always in Bible study, if you will, at this time, to bring together something through the Ferguson Southland Library with Evangelist Anderson to continue to be a greater part of our community with information and inspiration.
That's good. We also put something in the chat for Black History Month, resources from the Ferguson Library. There's a link. And also there are some programs that we have planned that we would love for the community to participate in. And Reverend Jackson, thank you. We will be glad to partner with such a dynamic, awesome group. So you all know me, I'm open. I just be led by the spirit, you know? So if it's good, my spirit will let me move with it. So thank you.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Well, to all of you, yes.
I just want to thank Brother Wilner Poppy Joseph and who submitted the questions, and we tried to get him on, but either way, I want to thank him for submitting some of those questions.
Yes, yes, we do. And
Jeray too, she gave some powerful questions as well.
Jeray and Brother Hyman. So we're thankful for all of you who participated, and again, to all of you. And on this day in which we remember the work, service, and legacy of Dr. King, that you'll go out and remember that we will not only overcome, but we will be free. And we must keep fighting, for in this context that we live in today, we must continue to battle and win, be victorious over white supremacy, no matter how it looks. And the problem is, sometimes we're not clear as to how we see each other in working with each other. But one thing, white supremacy know who we are. And we all look the same when you're non-white, when it comes to white supremacy. So let us work. Let us work while it's day, because the night will come. I bid you all good day and blessings to you. The Lord bless you and keep you. Mm-hmm.
Before we close, Pastor Bishop, because I just want to let the community know what we as the clergy in Stamford has been doing, because even though it has not been publicized, we do want the community to know that we've been very active within our community. This past week, there's a number of initiatives we have taken on. One is COVID testing. This past Saturday, we were just at Park 215 on 215 Stillwater, making sure that our communities were tested. We partnered with the city of Houston, along with the NAACP and Semaphore, to offer those testings. But then our pastors here in Stamford have been in communication and with our government and the mayor here in Stamford to make sure that that there's equitable employment for all. Too many times there aren't enough African-Americans and minorities on the board and commissions, and we have been advocating for that. Right now, we're in the midst of writing an amicus brief so that we can overturn the civil servants test that they have here, so more African-Americans can be, and minorities will be able to be considered for promotions and everything within. And so I just think it's good to know that we are your pastors, and we're not just here sitting back, but we are in the fight, and we're here for you during this time.
All right. Well, thank you, everyone, and have a blessed day. All right.
Right.
All right.
Take care, everyone. God bless, and thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Pastor Bush, I'll be in touch.
Yes, ma'am. All right.
Mm-hmm. Good day, everyone. God bless you. Good day. Uh-huh.
Good day. Good night.
All my friends. God bless.